Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
There is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in God's call to us.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you declare your almighty power chiefly in showing mercy and pity. Grant us the fullness of your grace, that we, running to obtain your promises, may become partakers of your heavenly treasure. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading of God's word.
A reading from the book of Esther. The king and Haman went in to feast with Queen Esther. On the second day, as they were drinking wine, the king again said to Esther, "What is your petition, Queen Esther? It shall be granted you. And what is your request? Even to the half of my kingdom it shall be fulfilled." Then Queen Esther answered, "If I have won your favor, O king, and if it pleases the king, let my life be given me, that is my petition, and the lives of my people, that is my request. For we have been sold, I and my people, to be destroyed, to be killed, and to be annihilated. If we have been sold merely as slaves, women, men and women, I would have held my peace, but no enemy can compensate for this damage to the king." Then King Ahasuerus said to Queen Esther, "Who is he? Where is he? Who has presumed to do this?" Esther said, "A foe, an enemy, this wicked Haman." Then Haman was terrified before the king and queen. Then Harbona, one of the eunuchs in attendance on the king, said, "Look, the very gallows that Haman has prepared for Mordecai, whose word saved the king, stands at Haman's house, 50 cubits high." And the king said, "Hang him on that." So they hanged Haman on the gallows that he had prepared for Mordecai. Then the anger of the king abated. Mordecai recorded these things and sent letters to all the Jews who were in all the provinces of King Ahasuerus, both near and far, enjoining them that they should keep the 14th day of the month Adar, and also the 15th day of the same month year by year, as the days on which the Jews gained relief from their enemies, and as the month that they had turned for them from sorrow into gladness, and from mourning into a holiday, that they should make them days of feasting and gladness, days for sending gifts of food to one another and presents to the poor." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us say together Psalm 124. If the Lord,
had not been on our side, let Israel now say.
If the Lord had not been on our side, when enemies rose up against us, then would they have swallowed us up alive in their fierce anger toward us. Then would the waters have overwhelmed us and the torrent gone over us. Then would the raging waters have gone right over us. Blessed be the Lord. He has not given us over to be a prey for their teeth. We have escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
A reading from the letter of James. Are any among you suffering? they should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up, and anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from the death and will cover a multitude of sins. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us. But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any one of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. For it is better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and to be thrown into hell, where the worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good. But if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
It is such a pleasure to be back here at Grace. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
There is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in God's call to us.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you declare your almighty power chiefly in showing mercy and pity. Grant us the fullness of your grace, that we, running to obtain your promises, may become partakers of your heavenly treasure. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading of God's word.
A reading from the book of Esther. The king and Haman went in to feast with Queen Esther. On the second day, as they were drinking wine, the king again said to Esther, "What is your petition, Queen Esther? It shall be granted you. And what is your request? Even to the half of my kingdom it shall be fulfilled." Then Queen Esther answered, "If I have won your favor, O king, and if it pleases the king, let my life be given me. That is my petition, and the lives of my people, that is my request. For we have been sold, I and my people, to be destroyed, to be killed, and to be annihilated. If we have been sold merely as slaves, women, men and women, I would have held my peace, but no enemy can compensate for this damage to the king." Then King Ahasuerus said to Queen Esther, "Who is he? Where is he? Who has presumed to do this?" Esther said, "A foe, an enemy, this wicked Haman." Then Haman was terrified before the king and queen. Then Harbona, one of the eunuchs in attendance on the king, said, "Look, the very gallows that Haman has prepared for Mordecai, whose word saved the king, stands at Haman's house, 50 cubits high." And the king said, "Hang him on that." So they hanged Haman on the gallows that he had prepared for Mordecai. Then the anger of the king abated. Mordecai recorded these things and sent letters to all the Jews who were in all the provinces of King Ahasuerus, both near and far, enjoining them that they should keep the 14th day of the month Adar, and also the 15th day of the same month, year by year, as the days on which the Jews gained relief from their enemies, and as the month that they have turned for them from sorrow into gladness, and from mourning into a holiday, that they should make them days of feasting and gladness, days for sending gifts of food to one another and presents to the poor. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us say together Psalm 124. If the Lord,
had not been on our side, let Israel now say.
If the Lord had not been on our side, when enemies rose up against us, then would they have swallowed us up alive in their fierce anger toward us. Then would the waters have overwhelmed us and the torrent gone over us. Then would the raging waters have gone right over us. Blessed be the Lord. He has not given us over to be a prey for their teeth. We have escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken, and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
A reading from the letter of James. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up. And anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from the death and will cover a multitude of sins. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
John said to him, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us. But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any one of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. For it is better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and to be thrown into hell where the worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good. But if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
It is such a pleasure to be back here at Grace Church. I joke that I spend more time in Waycross than any other city in the Diocese of Georgia. I just don't spend it at Grace. You can't go from Savannah to most of the western part of the state without going through Waycross. Unless you're on I-16, and I refuse to go on I-16 as much as I can. So, the Kroger Starbucks here is wonderful. Best diesel prices at the pump at the Kroger's. Just telling you, go there. I got my little Kroger card, swipe to get the discount and everything. I spent a lot of time in Waycross, mainly passing through. The onions at the Subway restaurant aren't so good. They need to work on the freshness of those. But other than that, I have no complaints. Waycross is good to me. But it's good to be here at Grace Church in Waycross and with all of you this morning. Please pray with me for a moment. Lord, somehow through my imperfect words and through our imperfect hearing, let the light of your gospel shine into our hearts and set our hearts on fire. Amen.
Amen.
From today's gospel, Jesus says, "Whoever is not against us is for us." I think in speaking these words, our Lord is breaking down a barrier between those who follow him outwardly and publicly, calling themselves Christians, and those who do not, at least not directly. Jesus says those who aren't following him still are doing deeds of power, still are doing good works, we might say. So the disciples simply ought to rejoice in that. But that's not what the disciples wanted to hear, right? The man who was casting out demons had not paid his dues with the disciples' union, you know? He wasn't part of the club. He hadn't been confirmed. What was wrong with him, right? hadn't had his membership card transferred from one parish to the other. And he hadn't been with Jesus from the beginning like the 12 disciples, so they were angry that this man had ignored all the rules and disregarded proper procedure. Today's gospel breaks down all of our desire to have things just the way we want them, to have all the rules follow the way we want them to be followed, to have the church be exactly the way we want the church to be. And the gospel speaks to the tension we all experience in our own following of Jesus Christ as one of his disciples. And it raises questions for us, like, who is in and who is out of the Lord's circle? How do we define those boundaries of who's in and who's out? What work does God bless and what work does God not bless? And does it have to have the church's name on it for it to be a good work? Now, Jesus calls his church to be missionaries. All of us who are baptized into the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ are baptized missionaries of the good news of Jesus. And in Matthew's gospel particularly, we learn that Jesus established the church for one primary function: to have good casseroles. No, that's not it. Jesus established, although I love casseroles, you know, I'm not going to get that. As long as they have fresh onions, I'm fine with that. He established the church for one purpose: to make disciples. That's it, to make disciples. As we say in our baptismal covenant that all of us are going to be renewing in a few minutes, we are to continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in the prayers. But what about the rest of the world out there, outside of the church, where we live and where we work? And in this larger community, we're connected to others, both inside the church and outside the church. And common concerns connect us with one another, like public safety, healthcare, education, what we used to call in this country the common good. We're all looking for the common good. And in this larger community, there are people who are doing good works. They're doing those deeds of power that the gospel refers to, that are congruent with what the church stands for. The opposite is also true, and I don't need to tell you this. There are those out there doing their best to tear down and subvert the purposes of God for God's creation. So where's the dividing line between the church and the world? Where is that? You and I have that dividing line running right down the middle of each one of us, don't we? We live in both all the time. So we shouldn't worry about who's in and who's out. I got news for you. Not your business. That is God's property. God brings us salvation. You and I don't. Rather, we should ask a more important question, not who's in and who's out. Who's out there living the gospel? Who's giving hope to the hopeless? Who's comforting the brokenhearted? Who's feeding the poor and the hungry? Who's giving mercy to the sinner? That's the more important question. We shouldn't be concerned about a person's race, sexual orientation, or their social class. Those things don't matter. The discerning test is this: are they trying to live the gospel? Now, you'll recall when, in John's gospel, when John the Baptist's disciples, when he was in prison, they came to Jesus, they were saying, "Well, wait a minute, we were following John, we were his disciples, now he's thrown in prison, looks like he's going to get his head cut off, we don't know what's going to do, and he said there was a Messiah coming, are you the real thing?" How does Jesus respond? Does he say, "Yep, that's me, I'm the real thing"? No, He says this, go tell John this. The lame are walking. The blind are receiving sight. The poor are having good news preached to them. In other words, if you and I want to be on the side of Jesus, then that's what we should be about. While I was in seminary, I served a church-sponsored ministry at St. Stephen's and the Incarnation Church in Washington, D.C. And the ministry basically was to go out in a church van and find folk who were homeless in the midst of a winter cold, and it can get mighty cold in D.C. in the winter, and to bring them back to the church where they could take a shower, get a hot meal, get some new clothes, maybe a new coat so they're warmer. And we would get, it was a church-sponsored ministry, but anybody could volunteer for it. Well, one day, I got paired with a social worker named Bobby. And Bobby knew I was in seminary, so the first thing he said to me, he says, I don't want to hear none of that Jesus stuff from you. I assured him that I would respect his agnosticism. But I also thought that sometime during the day, while we were driving around, looking for folk to bring back to the church, that I would work Jesus into the conversation. That I would tell him how much Jesus had changed my life. And how I've become a disciple of Jesus and my life had been transformed. And about an hour into our shift, we came upon a man who was literally lying in the gutter. They say, you know, somebody was in the gutter. This guy was in the gutter. And it was right outside of the ellipse, which overlooks the White House. Have you been to Washington? It is such a pleasure to be back here at Grace Church. I joke that I spend more time in Waycross than any other city in the Diocese of Georgia. I just don't spend it at Grace. You can't go from Savannah to most of the western part of the state without going through Waycross, unless you're on I-16, and I refuse to go on I-16 as much as I can. So, you know, the Kroger Starbucks here is wonderful. Best diesel prices at the pump at the Kroger's. Just telling you, go there. I got my little Kroger card, swipe to get the discount and everything. I spent a lot of time in Waycross, mainly passing through. The onions at the Subway restaurant aren't so good. They need to work on the freshness of those. But other than that, I have no complaints. Waycross is good to me. But it's good to be here at Grace Church in Waycross and with all of you this morning. Please pray with me for a moment. Lord, somehow through my imperfect words and through our imperfect hearing, let the light of your gospel shine into our hearts and set our hearts on fire. Amen. From today's gospel, Jesus says, whoever is not against us is for us. I think in speaking these words, our Lord is breaking down a barrier between those who follow him outwardly and publicly, calling themselves Christians, and those who do not, at least not directly. Jesus says those who aren't following him still are doing deeds of power, still are doing good works, we might say. So the disciples simply ought to rejoice in that. But that's not what the disciples wanted to hear, right? The man who was casting out demons had not paid his dues with the disciples' union, you know? He wasn't part of the club. He hadn't been confirmed. What was wrong with him, right? Hadn't had his membership card transferred from one parish to the other. And he hadn't been with Jesus from the beginning like the 12 disciples, so they were angry that this man had ignored all the rules and disregarded proper procedure. Today's gospel breaks down all of our desire to have things just the way we want them. To have all the rules followed the way we want them to be followed. To have the church be exactly the way we want the church to be. And the gospel speaks to the tension we all experience in our own following of Jesus Christ as one of his disciples. And it raises questions for us, like who is in and who is out of the Lord's circle? How do we define those boundaries of who's in and who's out? What work does God bless and what work does God not bless? And does it have to have the church's name on it for it to be a good work? Now, Jesus calls his church to be missionaries. All of us who are baptized into the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ are baptized missionaries of the good news of Jesus. And in Matthew's gospel particularly, we learn that Jesus established the church for one primary function: to have good casseroles. No, that's not it. Jesus established, although I love casseroles, you know, I'm not against that. As long as they have fresh onions, I'm fine with that. He established the church for one purpose: to make disciples. That's it. To make disciples. As we say in our baptismal covenant that all of us are going to be renewing in a few minutes, we are to continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in the prayers. But what about the rest of the world out there? Outside of the church, where we live and where we work. And in this larger community, we're connected to others, both inside the church and outside the church. And common concerns connect us with one another, like public safety, healthcare, education, what we used to call in this country the common good. We're all looking for the common good. And in this larger community, there are people who are doing good works. They're doing those deeds of power that the gospel refers to that are congruent with what the church stands for. The opposite is also true, and I don't need to tell you this. There are those out there doing their best to tear down and subvert the purposes of God for God's creation. So where's the dividing line between the church and the world? Where is that? You and I have that dividing line running right down the middle of each one of us, don't we? We live in both all the time. So we shouldn't worry about who's in and who's out. I got news for you. Not your business. That is God's property. God brings us salvation. You and I don't. Rather, we should ask a more important question, not who's in and who's out. Who's out there living the gospel? Who's giving hope to the hopeless? Who's comforting the brokenhearted? Who's feeding the poor and the hungry? Who's giving mercy to the sinner? That's the more important question. We shouldn't be concerned about a person's race, sexual orientation, or their social class. Those things don't matter. The discerning test is this: are they trying to live the gospel? Now, you'll recall when, in John's gospel, when John the Baptist's disciples, when he was in prison, they came to Jesus. They were saying, "Well, wait a minute, we were following John, we were his disciples, now he's thrown in prison, looks like he's going to get his head cut off. We don't know what's going to do." And he said there was a Messiah coming. Are you the real thing? How does Jesus respond? Does he say, "Yep, that's me. I'm the real thing"? No. He says this: "Go tell John this. The lame are walking. The blind are receiving sight. The poor are having good news preached to them." In other words, if you and I want to be on the side of Jesus, then that's what we should be about. While I was in seminary, I served a church-sponsored ministry at St. Stephen's and the Incarnation Church in Washington, D.C. And the ministry basically was to go out in a church van and find folk who were homeless in the midst of a winter cold, and it can get mighty cold in D.C. in the winter, and to bring them back to the church where they could take a shower, get a hot meal, get some new clothes, maybe a new coat so they're warmer. And we would get, it was a church-sponsored ministry, but anybody could volunteer for it. Well, one day, I got paired with a social worker named Bobby. And Bobby knew I was in seminary, so the first thing he said to me, he says, "I don't want to hear none of that Jesus stuff from you." I assured him that I would respect his agnosticism, but I also thought that sometime during the day, while we were driving around, looking for folk to bring back to the church, that I would work Jesus into the conversation, that I would tell him how much Jesus had changed my life, and how I've become a disciple of Jesus, and my life had been transformed. And about an hour into our shift, we came upon a man who was literally lying in the gutter. They say, you know, somebody was in the gutter. This guy was in the gutter. And it was right outside of the ellipse, which overlooks the White House. If you've been to Washington, D.C., there's an ellipse there, and he was right there in the gutter, and it was a cold, humid day. Now, y'all know about humidity here in Waycross. If you take the cold and you take the humidity, it's a bummer of a temperature out there. And as soon as we got out of the van, the smell coming from this man was horrendous. He clearly defecated on himself and had vomited numerous times on himself, and the air was this thick. As we got closer, I stopped and I turned to Bobby and I said, "Do you mind if you take this one?" He said, "Sure." He went back and picked up the man, whispered gentle words into his ear, picked him up, put him in the back of the van, and literally held this man in his lap the entire way back to the church. Soon after that, I decided that I was in no position to witness to Bobby about how Jesus had changed my life. You see, if anybody is doing the work of the gospel, then they're on the side of Jesus. Period. That seems to me to be as clear as a church bell. But we all know that not everyone sees it that way. Some want to control who does God's work, who gets credit for doing God's work, and who doesn't. They want things neatly divided about who's in and who's out. And more diabolically, they tell us to be afraid of those who are different than us. Fear has now become a religious commodity that is sold to the faithful on a regular basis, and we lap it up. It's a way for those in power to maintain control. If they can make us afraid that our very salvation is at stake, then we'll live by such fear rather than by faith and the loving power of Jesus Christ. As I read the gospel, Jesus seems to be less concerned about his disciples being right than he is with them actually living out the good news in their lives. He seems less concerned with the purity of their arguments or the rigidity of their doctrine, and more concerned with the purity of their hearts and the flesh and blood practices of living out the gospel in their life each day, right? Yet we live in a time, my friends, where the purity of arguments and the rigidity of doctrine seem very important to so many people. And fear is driving that need for rigidity and purity. But we must know that such fear-mongering about people who are different than we are will only lead to our own collective downfall, not only as a church, but as a country. One of my favorite episodes of the old TV series, The Twilight Zone, is about a meteor that lands near Maple Street in some small town in Middle America. Soon rumors begin on the street that aliens disguised as humans have invaded Maple Street. So everyone's electricity on the block goes out. So the people gather in the middle of the street, and one neighbor begs for everyone to remain calm. Please calm down. Let's don't do anything rash. But then the lights go on in his house, but nobody else's. So one of the neighbors says that he must be the alien disguised as a human being. As suspicion and panic overtake the street, soon guns come out. In the distance, an alien is seen walking towards them down the middle of Maple Street, and he's promptly shot. And they run up to him, look down, and discover that he was just one of their neighbors who'd gone for help. The next scene, towards the close of the episode, is of a nearby hill overlooking Maple Street, where two real aliens are seen with the device that manipulates electricity. One tells the other that there's no need to attack the humans. No. All you have to do is turn off and on a number of their machines, and they will pick the most dangerous enemy imaginable, themselves. Then the host, Rod Serling, as he always did at the end of every episode, appears on camera, and he concludes with these words that are prophetic 40, 50 years later. The tools of conquest don't necessarily come with bombs and explosions. There are more powerful weapons, the ones found in the thoughts, attitudes, and prejudices of men. Wow. We argue about who's in and who's out, who has the correct position and who doesn't. And we listen to voices who tell us to fear those who are different than us, those who are on the outside of whatever side we're on. My friends, Jesus would rather prefer us just to live the gospel and stay away from picking and choosing who's in and who's out. We shouldn't care whether somebody thinks that we're a liberal or a conservative. What does that mean anyway anymore? And if someone outside the church is doing a good work, even though they're not a Christian or a member of the church, we should just say, hallelujah, amen. I'm glad that person's feeding the hungry or teaching that child to read. Amen. One day, all of us are going to stand before the great judgment seat of Christ. We are. The scriptures are clear. Every one of us is going to stand before the great judgment seat of Christ. I'm trying to imagine that for myself. I won't project it onto you. I'm just trying to imagine that for myself. I don't think Jesus is going to ask me, now, Bishop, did you have the correct position on every theological point of doctrine? He's not going to ask me, now, did you hold fast against all those who were opposed to the church? I don't think he's going to ask me that either. I think he's going to ask me, Scott, buddy, compadre, friend, did you bring good news to the poor? Did you bring hope to the hopeless? Did you comfort those who suffered? Did you give mercy and forgiveness to those who sinned against you? Did you seek peace in the midst of violence? I think those are the questions he's going to ask me. Not about rigidity or purity. Now, I may well be wrong about what Jesus is going to ask me. I don't know. I have been wrong before. I'll be wrong again. But I'm willing to stake my eternal life on that. And I ask you to as well. Amen.
Amen.
candidates will now be presented.
I present Donna, Jennifer, and Margie for confirmation, and I present Barbara to be received into this communion.
Would those folks and their sponsors please stand? These questions are addressed to the candidates that Mother Kit mentioned. Do you reaffirm your renunciation of evil? Do you renew your commitment to Jesus Christ? And this is addressed to the entire congregation here gathered. I invite you to please stand as you are able. Will all of you who witness these vows do all in your power to support these persons and their life in Christ?
We will.
Let us join with those who are committing themselves to Christ and renew our own baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
You believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in the prayers?
I will, with God's help.
You persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord.
I will, with God's help.
We proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ.
I will, with God's help.
You seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself.
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Let us now pray for these persons who have renewed their commitment to Christ.
Deliver them, O Lord, from the way of sin and death.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Open their hearts to your grace and truth.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Fill them with your holy and life-giving spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Teach them to love others in the power of the Spirit.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Send them into the world in witness to your love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Bring them to the fullness of your peace and glory.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Mighty God, we thank you that by the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, you have overcome sin and brought us to yourself. That by the sealing of your Holy Spirit, you have bound us to your service. Renew in these, your servants, the covenant you made with them at their baptism. Send them forth in the power of that Spirit to perform the service you set before them. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Thank you. Defend, O Lord, your servant Jennifer with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more until she comes to your everlasting kingdom.
Amen. Amen.
Defend, O Lord, your servant Donna with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more until she comes to your everlasting kingdom.
Amen. Amen.
Defend, O Lord, your servant Margie with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever and daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more until she comes to your heavenly kingdom.
Amen. Amen.
Barbara, we recognize you as a member of the one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We receive you into the fellowship of this communion. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep you.
Amen.
Join hands with somebody next to you, or elbows. Let your fatherly hand ever be over these, your servants. Let your Holy Spirit ever be with them. And so lead them in the knowledge and obedience of your word, that they may serve you in this life and dwell with you in the life to come. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
My sisters and brothers, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
It's wonderful to see so many folks. Thank y'all for coming out today as we celebrate welcoming new members into our family, the family of God. We want to welcome Bishop Benhase with us, returning once again. And we ask that you stay after the service and be a part of the reception. We're honoring our new confirmands and receivings, and you get a chance to talk to the bishop and visit a little bit. I can't read my own writing.
Oh.
I hate when that happens. Thank you. Oh, the bishop's discretionary fund. The undesignated funds today go to the bishop's discretionary fund, and As I said last Sunday, we have benefited from that in years past when we had the fires several years ago. The bishop donated money for us to help the workers. So it's money goes for many, many good things throughout the diocese and other places too, to help those in need. There is on the font in the back a listing of upcoming things, so I could make this announcement shorter. So please take that and mark your calendars of what's coming up. Oh, thank you.
Indeed, it's a pleasure to be with you all this morning. Just want to preach a second sermon, actually my third. I had one before the service started, and that is, please don't think what you do doesn't matter. It does, and I think sometimes we think that because our churches aren't, you know, huge places where there's like a zillion things going on at one time, every little act of kindness and mercy and grace that you extend to another person brings God's kingdom just a little bit closer in this world. So what you do collectively as Grace Church, what you do individually as a disciple of Jesus matters, and it matters greatly. So never think what you do is meager or unimportant, because it does. And I know that you're all, as a church, discerning what is God up to in this place, and what is God calling us to outside of this place and a greater witness around Waycross. And I think those are the right questions to ask. What is God doing, and how might we participate in what God is doing? Rather than saying, how can we convince God to do what we want to do? You know, there's a difference, right? And I know that your upcoming program on grief is a huge gift to the larger community. So many people hurt on a regular basis. Life is tough. Anybody that tells you, I really am preaching a third sermon now, but I can't help myself. hold me back. I once heard a youth director tell a bunch of high school kids, this is the best time of your life. You know, you're in high school, you're growing, you're learning. And I'm thinking back to my high school days, going, why did you just lie to that group of high school kids? I mean, I had the biggest zit in the world on my, I looked like Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer for 4 years in high school, and no one would talk to me because I looked like, you know, at any time, that thing could explode and kill everybody in the room. High school was horrible, you know? Don't tell high school kids you're having the best time of your life. Well, maybe they are, but maybe they're not. And life is hard. And I think God made it hard because it was a way of calling us to hold on to one another and to support one another and to learn in this life what it means to love one another. Not when things are good and easy. Heck, anybody can do that. But to love one another when it's hard. When they're hurting. And Waycross is hurting. A lot of people in this community are hurting. A lot of you are hurting. So whatever you can do to bring comfort to those who are hurting is a great witness for the gospel. It's a great witness for the gospel. So your program on grief that's coming up, thank you for doing that. But there are other things that God is calling you to be about. Pay attention and listen. And you have to be quiet long enough to listen to what God's saying rather than fill up all that time with what you want to say to God. But I'm convinced God's going to let you know what that is. Just pay attention and listen. Ascribe with the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his court.
also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, because in Jesus Christ our Lord, you have received us as your daughters and sons, made us citizens of your kingdom, and given us the Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin, become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he'd given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. At the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Jesus Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is given for you, deserved. Standing or kneeling as we were able, let us pray together our post-communion prayer. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all persons, love and serve the Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
name of Christ. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
I think that's alleluia.